Your Holiness, we await and eager to listen to you. Thank you.
Suppose this sort of meeting, just one lecture, not teaching. So I didn't sort of wear the bhikshu robe. Rinpoche wear. So I think today Rinpoche's turn, Dharma wheel. So already Rinpoche prepared. I'm not prepared. So in any way, I really feel great honor and very happy meeting the large number of people here and organize Rinpoche organization and this small Singaporean. Since many years, see we know each other, and particularly when I was a transit survey, transit short stop at Singapore airport, she always very, very helpful. So since we know each other, so she, I think, no hesitation to some sort of exaggeration about my greatness. Thank you. Thank you. Ale, my old long-time friend, hello.
Good. God, thank you for being here with us.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'm sorry we came a bit.
No, no, no. It's my duty. Receiving one long-time friend and a foreign secretary. He always, you see, showing genuine sort of feeling, genuine concern. So I very much appreciate. Sure. This kind of public meeting, this third time, second time, third time, I think third time, second. Oh. So the last one, which year? Huh?
2004.
Four. So then, let me introduce myself. At that time and today, one difference is, now today my body, my human body, not complete, because remove the gallbladder about two years ago. So now my body, not complete human body. And again, I think I want to argue with my friend the event on my life not I can not sort of my own sort of control. This surgery of the gallbladder, I do not want that. So I think at least around 15 years, I just wait and put all my hope to Tibetan medicine. So Tibetan physician also used to promise me using Tibetan medicine that gallbladder sort of stone can melt it. So I put hope on that. I think after 15 years, that hope is empty hope. So I always teasing my Tibetan physician. You put me empty hope last 15 years. anyway, so that is surgery, not according to my wish, but circumstances, you see, they brought, there is no other choice, but I have to remove through surgery, like that. So in any way, basically my health, very good. So now here, actually, I always make clear when big gathering, you see, yesterday happen. I always make clear we are same human being. The speaker, listener, we both same human being, same human body. So, emotionally, mentally, physically, we are same human being. And then more important, everyone want happy life, successful life. And most important, everyone have the right to achieve happy life. There's no differences, absolutely same. Then from the Buddhist viewpoint, particularly the Sanskrit tradition's viewpoint, everybody have Buddha nature. So long consciousness and different level of consciousness there are, innermost subtle consciousness, and it is ultimate reality that usually we call Buddha nature. So the ultimate seed of Buddha, or Buddhahood, is that subtle consciousness. So that all sentient beings who have the experience of sort of knowing that consciousness there. That consciousness, subtle consciousness, is the basis of all grosser level of consciousness. Obviously, in our daily life, now like this moment, we are experiencing or active our grosser level of consciousness, including sensorial consciousness, very active. I can see, I can hear, I can smell, I can taste, I can touch. So the five sensorial sort of consciousness, very active. Each sort of sensorial sort of consciousness, behind the mental consciousness. So the sensorial level consciousness, I think generally speaking, no ability to judge. So when we see something, hear something, then, oh, this is good, this is something. And sometimes we remember, or once I heard that, that's the sixth mental sort of work. So after each sort of consciousness, there's the sixth sort of mental consciousness always go that way, together or sometimes follow, like that. So then, in dream state, these senses of organs no longer function, no longer active. But the mental level experience still there, active. So its own special sort of, what's the day, different sort of, I mean, with dream, certain sort of, what's the day, seeing, hearing, and mental level, something. Suglia, Chedikijibe Suksa Shigdua, Mashi Sug Ranshi Yimbala, the Ombushebe Pigrigmotuachi, Yishigriachi Shigdua.
In Buddhist philosophy, we speak of a kind of form which is in the mental state, something which cannot be perceived by sensorial mental factors or sensorial faculties, but can only be perceived mentally. Such kind of form is called subtle mental form.
So within that, also you see there are differences. I think different category about, I think, five. So then another level of consciousness, deep sleep without dreaming, without dream, another level of consciousness. So according to our daily sort of experience, we already sort of notice there are different levels of consciousness. So all these consciousness, the different level of consciousness, on the basis of subtle sort of consciousness, the subtle consciousness continuously there. So so we all have the seat of Buddha or Tathagata Garbha. My friend knows Sanskrit, isn't it? Sanskrit. So please examine my sort of pronunciation. Tathagata Garbha, okay. Or Sugata Shindaya. So this, the Sanskrit word is Buddha nature, Buddha seed. So we all same. We all have the same potential to become Buddha. That's Buddhist viewpoint. So, and because of that, everyone have the ability to overcome our ignorance. That means everybody have the ability to create, as the what you call wisdom or paranya. The sort of what's the knowledge about different level of reality and ultimately the ultimate reality. So long consciousness there, so long the ability of awareness there, so that potential we everyone have. So the method to develop that awareness, human intelligence, is important. So from that viewpoint, sentient being with human body, human brain, we well equipped, you see, to gaso da shukshun tamas gaso re ko ya number 7 number 7
activate
that subtle consciousness or that wisdom. So we are, so basically, the point is, basically we all, it's the same. So should not sort of think the speaker is something special and from you. That kind of view is totally wrong. We are same. When Buddha taught us the teaching, he mentioned you also have the same the ability, the same nature of mind, ultimately Buddha nature. So he always emphasized that. Since it's Buddha, Buddhism, Buddha Dharma, no idea of concept of creator, like Jainism, these two Indian tradition, no concept of creator, ourself as a creator. So samsara, which of course samsara, general, not my creation, but my own sort of samsara, is my own creation. Ultimately, that a subtle mind, overwhelmed by grosser level of mind, then all those, destructive emotion, without control. So that creates negative karma. That creates my own samsara. Similarly, once I develop the realization of that nature and then try to reduce these negative emotion, destructive emotion. Destructive emotion not voluntarily come, but because of ignorance. So the ultimate sort of the method is remove the ignorance. Way of remove ignorance, not through prayer, not pray to God or pray to Buddha, won't sort of disappear. Ignorance also a fact, a factor, or phenomena. And mental phenomena. So naturally, I mean, by nature, there is opposite sort of force. So the proper way to elimination of this ignorance is, the development of the awareness of the reality. The ultimate ignorance is the misunderstand or misconception about ultimate reality. So in order to remove that, the right awareness about the reality. So that's the only way to develop. That also is we can do. I myself. Now, over 76 years old, through my own training, my own sort of, some meditation, not very, very perfect, very high level of meditation, but some low level of meditation. I think last almost, I think now, nearly 60 years. Decade by decade, some sort of improvement, gaining some strength about these deeper awareness. So that reduce that effect on the ignorance, on the misconception of the reality. So we all have the same sort of nature, same potential, same ability. Of course, that is about the Buddhist thinking. Now here I'm going to talk about secular ethics. Not talking about religion, not talking about God, not talking about Buddha or Buddhahood, these things. Simply, how to be more calm person, Calmness is the basis of satisfaction. And also calm mind, also very good for our physical health. Oh, I want to share with you one my sort of secret. That is, when I went through surgery about the removing gallbladder. So the gallbladder was enlarged almost 3 times, and also with pus. So then the last sort of check by specialist about gallbladder, then they expressed to me, now you can't think weeks and weeks, only matter of hours or days. Now very dangerous sort of stage. There's every danger to
explode.
If that's case, if such things happen, then very dangerous. Then I immediately went to the hospital, the Gangaram hospital, and then the next day is the surgery. So usually those healthy body, even 15, 20 minutes, they can also complete. They can they can finish. But my case, 2 hours. The surgeon, very specialist, very experienced. The Dr. Choe, very, very sort of experienced. So quite serious, the surgery, quite serious. But then, within 5 days, they recover, rapidly recover. And then within 1 week, there's some things was put here, also they remove, and everything, then okay, become normal. So then concerned the doctor or nurses, surprise. The speed sort of recovery, they're a little bit surprised on my age.
Speedy recovery.
So of course I have nothing special, but I convinced then my mental state quite calm. Even on the bed, the surgery, I feel okay. Some teasing, some of the nurses, some of the doctors, like that. Then, of course, after Kaza, Shime.
And anesthesia.
Oh, after that, of course, no feeling. But till that, I smiling, and you see some cases teasing. If they made little mistake, then I always teasing like that. So they, I think 5 days in the hospital. So within a short period, those nurses, who take care of me, we become very close friend. So later, the concerned people later expressed to me. While I was there, that part of the hospital, some kind of whole atmosphere is something different. After I left, they felt something missing. So this is nothing special. I think my mental state quite calm. So that much. From my own experience, I can tell you, you can train your mind. Through that way, you can bring inner peace. Not through prayer, but through training, but through awareness. So whenever I meet, you see, people or public talk, I always stress material values, of course, very important, but there is limitation. So it is absolutely wrong to seek deep satisfaction from material values, from money, from power, from fame. It's wrong. Ultimate source of satisfaction, ultimate source of happiness within ourselves, on mental level, that you should know. So material development, important, without money. You cannot lead your life properly. We need. But if we put all our hope on matter, on material value, then your life will be miserable life. Some of my friend, a businessman, I sometimes teasing some of my friend, oh, you are a slave of money. They are very busy for money. And for money, lie, cheating. Because money brings jealousy, extreme competitive, negative competitive sort of feeling. As soon as jealousy comes, the genuine openness, genuine trust reduce once you develop some kind of feeling of jealousy, even with your, as a long-time friend, long-time sort of even parent or brother, sisters, if jealousy develop, then emotionally you become a little distance. Then eventually distrust. And you have to speak hypocritic way. That destroy trust. Without trust, friendship cannot develop. Without a friend, we social, as a social animal, without human affection, no matter you are billionaire, you are president of powerful nation, you will not be happy. Even remain as a beggar with companions where trust, friendship, materially poor, but mentally very rich, very happy. So that I always share with people, because now it, the sort of modern time, everybody, you see, they rushing, making money. And we believe if you have money, all problem can solve. That's wrong. Money important, but at the same time, there's no point to neglect about our inner values. That's very important. How many Tibetans here? The Peba so Lama John de ya. Peba? De Guru do. That Tadwa you have Peba. Tugay. Tugay. Me Peba. Oh. Oh yeah. So, so nowadays, we Tibetan, say now, also using the more and more Tibetan, now really worship money, particularly dollar. I openly, you see, sort of what's it, expressing, you know, our way of approach regarding Tibetan problem, not seeking separation. Because Tibet, materially very backward, Tibetan also loves money. Tibetan also is want to modernize Tibet. So one reason, several hundred Tibetans illegally immigrated to Europe, some of the European countries, and also Canada and America. These illegal sort of immigration,
immigrants.
Not for seeking spirituality, but seeking dollar. So we also want modernized and more material development. So in that case, remain within the People's Republic of China. We get much benefit, provided our main concern is preservation of Tibetan culture, Tibetan spirituality. As far as Buddhism is concerned, now I've found really Tibetan Buddha Dharma, which directly come from Nalanda tradition, because Shanda Rakshita himself went to Tibet on the invitation of Tibetan emperor, 8th century or 8th or 9th century, I think late and early, I think 9th century maybe. So pure Nalanda tradition, including Buddhist logic, that complete form of Buddha Dharma available only in Tibetan tradition, very clear. So that not only a Tibetan treasure, but we can say world treasure. So preserve that, not only interest for 6 million Tibetan people, but also the millions of young Chinese and also the many other people, of course. So therefore, we want to preserve that. So that I usually call middle way. So now here I'm talking, see, I'm teaching Tibetan. Sometimes I also see, because I'm joking, we Tibetan usually, you see, recite the sacred mantra of our Lokiteshwara. That mantra. So sometimes we a little bit hurry, and we also, you see, the sound looks like Om Mani, Om Mani, Om Mani, Om Mani, Om Mani, like that. So that also, the sound looks like money, 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 that. I think that's true expression of Tibetan. We want dollar, we want money, 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 that. So, young Indian, also you see the more attraction about external sort of development. And there is danger to neglect about your own thousand-year-old Indian treasure, your treasure. Be careful. Unless, you see, at the young age, and also the environment, you see, sometimes, you see, bring certain sort of interest, only money. And these sort of material values which gives you some satisfaction through sensorial experiences. Like sports, eye consciousness, music, ear consciousness, smell, taste, these things, again, through sensorial consciousness, you get some satisfaction. So that kind of satisfaction completely relying on external matters. So when these external facility not there, then you really feel boring. Sometimes I feel some of the tourists, some old people, the sufficient money, but they cannot sort of spend days on sort of what is it, thinking some inner what is it, values, because their whole life relying on a consciousness, certain sort of satisfaction which produced by sensorial level. So when these facilities not there, when your life not active, then you really feel boring. Then go different places and see some new place and hear new music. That's the only source of satisfaction. That's quite a pity. Those people who have some sort of experience to think about inner value and use mental sort of ability, not relying on sensorial thing, that person, when you live as a hermit, you get sort of the most sort of the greatest sort of satisfaction through analyze reality and thinking about the reality. So these people, not only Buddhist, but also you see they follow of other tradition. One time I met one Catholic monk in Barcelona, one monastery, Catholic monastery, Monsu Road or something. So when I visit there, the one Catholic monk came to see me and the organizer about my visit, they told me that Catholic monk 5 years remained in the mountain just behind the Montserrat monastery or temple. 5 years with very little sort of hot meal, some biscuits, some bread, like that. So when he came to see me, I already, because they informed me, so I already developed some kind of genuine respect and appreciation. Then I asked him, I was told, you spent 5 years in the mountain like hermit. What kind of practice? I asked him. His answer is meditation of compassion. When he answered that, in his eye, some special sort of what's it, expression. So, different religious tradition, different philosophy. Some say there's God, creator, some say no God. Doesn't matter. That's a philosophical sort of field. But according different individual mental disposition, different way of approach is necessary. It doesn't matter. But the important is the real aim, real goal.
Purpose.
So all these different religious traditions, they say they have the same potential to increasing our practice of love and compassion, forgiveness, these things. So such person spent 5 years, and also among Tibetan, also among sort of the Hindu practitioner, years, remain very isolated place. They whole life, not sleep, but you see some meditation, some thinking. Through that way, they seek deeper satisfaction through meditation. So no need relying on external factors like that. So we Tibetan, I want to tell, we Tibetan, you see, we have rich cultural heritage and very sophisticated Nalanda philosophy, Nalanda view. So it is really worthwhile to think more these things, then your life become fuller. Like that. So in any way, they pay more attention about our inner ability in order to achieve calm mind. Calm mind works and brings two benefits. One benefit calm mind brings your physical sort of composition where, or physical element work more balanced way. So your health improve. Your health sustain. Even according to some medical scientists, they say anger, hatred, fear, actually eating our immune system. Whereas meditate on compassion brings blood pressure reduce, stress reduce. Some university in America, Emory University in Atlanta, last few years they carry some experiment. And also, Stanford University also have now serious program. And Wisconsin University also carry some serious sort of program, research these sort of mental state and how much sort of benefit to our health. So recently I was in, last year I visited all these three universities and some sort of talk with scientists. So Emory University, one example is they carry some sort of on experimental level. Some student, 3 weeks program about training of mind, about compassion, these things. So after 3 weeks, is it their concentration power on the subject which they are studying, concentration power becoming more stable, and their mind becomes sharper. And then their relation with the classmate, other student, becoming much more peaceful or gentler. So this socio-karada relations much sort of peaceful, much sort of improve. And then also one occasion, some sort of scientist carry some sort of experiment. Group of people, before carrying their sort of some kind of meditation. They check blood pressure and stress, all these things. Then after a few weeks training, each day, about 30 minutes, or some sort of meditation on love, compassion. So after a few days, few weeks, again they test, blood pressure reduce, amount of stress also reduce. Individual person becoming much more calmer, much more happier. So these are not just, idea, but some university, some scientist, genuine well-known scientist, they already carried as an experiment. Now they found quite significant sort of result, like that. So that physical level, calm mind, very sort of positive factor. Then another thing, human intelligence is really precious. So in order to carry human precious properly, calm mind is very necessary. Once our mind become biased, our mind disturbed by emotion, then our basic sort of mind then become much disturbed. Then these negative emotion develop. Then our whole sort of view become biased. we cannot sort of see the reality objectively. Many mistakes at global level or national level or international level, many of these, like the Iraq war. You see, the situation look little bit, with a little bit, so to say, the biased mind,
yes, biased.
Not objectively and not holistically. So these sort of mistakes is happen. Even our family level also, you see, in order to see the reality, our mind must be calm and look, investigate objectively. Then we get clear picture. So our mind calm, we can utilize our ability to see, to investigate reality more properly. Once our mind disturbed, then you can't see, you can't utilize our investigation objectively. So calm mind, very important. Calm mind does not mean we remain indifferent. No. With feeling, with recognition, this is night, this is positive, this is negative. But not much sort of, I think intellectual level, yes, this is good, I must do this. This is bad, I must sort of, kasota.
Abstain.
Restrain.
Refrain.
Clear sort of distinction, right and wrong, and the negative and the positive, and short-term consequences, long-term consequences. But then deeper level, emotional level, more or less neutral. That we can do. So occasionally, this morning also, is I just expressed, the 2 days ago, is I burst my temper to somebody, sort of staff member. But, you know, short period, some anger, but then go, not remain. That we can do. If our basis of the mental attitude is quite sort of healthy, then these destructive emotion comes and goes. I always telling as a sort of example, like ocean, wave always come and go, comes and go. But underneath, always calm. So our mind also can do that. Different destructive emotions come and go. And these emotions, actually, I think biological factor, attachment, biological factor. Biased love, compassion, also biological factor. Anger, fear. Also biological factor. I think many of you may know or may not, according to sort of scientists, when anger develops, then blood goes more on hand, so ready to fight. When fear develops, blood go more on leg, run away. So these are biological factors. So, biologically, we equipped with these things in order to protect oneself. Anger, push, because of negative things. Attachment, bring positive things for one's own survival. Even flowers, no consciousness, but due to chemical, they also have a certain capacity to bring their positive thing for their survival and push the something harmful, like that. So then we, of course, not only physical level, but also mental level. So, but using human intelligence, human awareness, their thinking, long-term interest, long-term benefit, and short-term sort of satisfaction, short-term sort of benefit, then because of our intelligence, long-term, greater benefit is more important than the short-term satisfaction. So we, with help of human intelligence, we can sort of, what is it, reduce some of these destructive emotion, although biological factor, but we can reduce. So, and secular ethics, I think awareness and training of mind. Training means familiarize certain things. That's what we call meditation. Meditation means, you see, our main sort of view or main mind familiarize and a certain sort of mind or a certain sort of object. Like that. So through that way, we can train our mind. Through that way, eventually, for example, when anger develops, if you have some sort of experience through training, you can separate from the anger. You can watch anger by yourself. Once you separate yourself from anger, so the anger's dominance no longer possible, then this because of the strength or intensity of anger automatically reduce. So through training, you see, we can do these things. All these, I think, the ability of human intelligence. So that's why, you see, many spiritual literature, you see, mentioned human body is something precious, like that. So now, I think that's the main point. You see, everyone want a happy life, and the ultimate source of happiness, satisfaction. Now, when I say happiness, I think mainly means satisfaction. So even suffering, even physical suffering, can bring deeper satisfaction at the mental level. Even these sports, they really physically, this sort of very hard work, sometimes it's difficult, but that brings tremendous satisfaction on mental level. So satisfaction and suffering, not because of the opposite way. Right? So here, happiness, not necessarily sort of pleasant experience, but happiness mainly here, satisfaction. So happy life, or satisfactory life, ultimate source is within ourselves. That, please, should know that. So pay more attention about our inner quality, inner value. Even you want to harm someone, the method should be realistic. In order to carry realistic method, you see, your mind must be calm. Then your approach to hit your neighbor who always create a problem for you, then your hit really hit effectively. If your mind too much anger, then try to criticize, try to do something harm on them, may not hit real target. Isn't it? I think one example, your neighbor, if you see your neighbor, you see, create some problem for you, and you want to some sort of, what's the day, kasuda, harm, if you remain calm without anger without much emotion. Your sort of attitude still remain very pleasant attitude. So your friend continuously come and even increase. More visitors come. Then your neighbor feel more worry. Other hand, because of some trouble due to your neighbor, if you lost your because of the peace of mind, and you always sort of irritate and bad mood, then visitor certainly will reduce. Then eventually you feel some uncomfortable, some illness or some uncomfortable. So doctor, you have to call one doctor. Then your neighbor really feel happy. Now my neighbor, now no visitor, no sort of happy mood, and now even doctor also calling. So something goes wrong. So they feel very happy. So anger, hatred, actually self-destruction. So instead of that, you remain calm. And then investigate what is the best way to hit on your neighbor. Then utilize that realistically. Then you get real deeper satisfaction. So calm mind is very, very important. So when we face some problems, we should not let out anger, this negative emotion. Try to minimize and use our intelligence about the reality. That's important. That I want to share with you. That's what I usually call the method, the value of human values, nothing to do with religion. Then for religion, second level, those people who believe religion, 1,000-year-old India's tradition, religious harmony. That's now I realize India is really only country where all major religious tradition live together. This really greatness of India. Beside a homegrown different religious tradition, all major religious tradition eventually, you see, they establish or deeply rooted in this country. Look, Parsi, very small community, but no threat. They happily settle and they carry their own 1,000-year-old sort of traditional spiritual tradition practice. In Bombay mainly, their community in Bombay, their population less than 100,000. But they not only maintain their own faith, their own tradition, but also they, from their community, they made really significant sort of contribution for national sort of work in military field, like General Manekshaw, Parsi, isn't it? In economy field, like Tata, I think Parsi community. So very small community, but they happily settle here. So of course, about this billion population, some mischievous people, always possible. But overall, India, I think 1,000 years, the religious harmony kept alive. So this is very, very important. This is really your treasure. Then your sort of ahimsa concept. Because of ahimsa sort of concept, tolerant, different religious concept, different religious community, from outside, welcome. give them shelter and friendly sort of kasota, receive them. So I think these mainly ahimsa concept. So these two things, the ahimsa and the religious harmony, these two things are really India's treasure. So now time come, world need these two things, ahimsa and religious sort of harmony. The rest of the world really need these two things. So India, not just word, but 1,000 years, these things still alive tradition, living tradition. So this is really model of the rest of the world. So Indian people should realize that and should realize your own treasure, not only ancient treasure, but very relevant to today's world. And I often used to telling, I think you know, that I describe myself as a messenger of India, messenger of ancient Indian thought. That means ahimsa and religious harmony. We Tibetan, actually chela of Indian guru. So you Indian is guru, we chela. So relation between Tibetan and Indian is something like relation between guru and chela. And I also is it telling my Indian friend, we not only just a chela, but a reliable chela. Reason, you see, the Nalanda tradition last several centuries, you see, a lot of sort of, what's it, the sort of destruction or damage. And in any way, ups and downs, too much ups and downs, Buddhist tradition in this country, their own land. But during this period, we Tibetan, as your chela, kept this tradition up to now, intactly. So that, I think, sufficient reason to say we are reliable chela of Indian guru. Okay. So now, meantime, I also, you see, now appealing my Indian sort of gurus, and particularly when I gathered the swamis and some sort of religious leaders like Rishikishi or some Hardwar, this area, I appealing. I am as a messenger of Indian tradition, Indian sort of treasure. So messenger's level, I sort of make my every effort, you see, to propagate these things. So now my guru should take more active role promoting these values, ahimsa and religious harmony. So sometimes I a little bit sort of critically I expressing that some of our guru, you see, they simply, you see, carry their rituals and some sort of ceremony and fail to bring these values to public, make relevance, these treasures relevant to our day-to-day life. I think that is very important. So the religious leader or scholars now must come out and tell people, share with people these values. So that, I mean, active sort of work for promotion of these 1,000-year-old tradition or treasure. I want to share with these public sort of people like that. And then meantime, we also, you see, need more sort of closer pay attention, this gap now growing, this gap rich and poor within the country. And also the gap between urban area and rural area. I think these are very, very important. Please pay more attention. make some more effort. And then also like caste system and dowry system and some other sort of outdated sort of part of Indian, you may call Indian culture or Indian sort of also habit.
Trends.
Ka.
Trends.
Ka.
Trends.
Ka.
Trends.
Oh, I don't know that word. So in any way, you see, they even maybe part of your sort of tradition, but these are outdated. Now must I accept a part of our tradition, but outdated must change. So since we become a refugee, I always make clear that the part of Tibetan culture, there could be two categories. One culture heritage, although part of Tibetan culture, but due to social system or certain sort of certain political or social system. So such sort of habit is outdated. Now, okay, sufficient, put in museum. Must be that culture. That other part of culture, which something really benefit in our day-to-day life, particularly when we're facing some problem, the immense sort of help to maintain our peace of mind and holistic view, such sort of part of our culture is really worthwhile to preserve and can preserve. Other, we cannot preserve and no use to preserve. So similarly, our guru's tradition also, I think there are some maybe outdated, so must change. So these change should sort of initiated by the spiritual leaders and come out to speak. That I feel important. So that's about my talk. Now some questions. Question two written, also good. And someone, if you want to question directly, also most welcome. If you provide some microphone. First read. Question, yes.
No, before the question, I would request Arvind Sitaraman and family to come to the backstage, please. Thank you.
Your Holiness, I have the questions.
Yes,
and answers here.
Good.
Okay. So, Your Holiness, attachments
hold
are...
Attachments
are bad, but human relationships are good. How to reconcile this contradiction?
Oh, no contradiction. Attachment is actually, I think, one sort of also the one effective sort of emotion. So there are as an element of closeness feeling. But since that closeness feeling is very much in the nature of attachment, so it is biased. So the biased sort of closeness feeling, that's attachment, often bring suspicion, hatred. So human compassion, respect other, and what say they, sense of genuine concern of others' well-being. That's not attachment. That kind of thing is unbiased. So when we're training that kind of compassion, firstly, we have to practice or meditate, detach. Detach create sort of the sound basis, then develop or say the some kind of unbiased attachment or sort of
closeness
and genuine sense of concern of well-being. Again here, the biased love, biased compassion mainly related with self-centered attitude. This is something nice to me. This is my friend. This is my parent. This is my relative. So that is the main reason, develop sense of concern of their well-being. So that very much oriented about others' behavior. So those people who create uncomfortable for you, you see, there is no basis to develop sense of concern or well-being of them. Because that kind of sense of well-being is biased, ultimately related with self-centered attitude. Now, not that kind of sort of oriented, but oriented the person. The person or people, just like me, want happiness, do not want suffering, and on that level, develop sense of concern of their well-being. Not this is something close to me, not that way, but they themselves, also like me, want happiness, do not want suffering, yet they are passing through suffering. So on that basis, develop sense of concern. That is not action-oriented, but people-oriented. So now here, no differences. Your enemy, your friend, or neutral people, all same people or same sentient being. So same reason to develop sense of concern of their well-being. So that's unbiased. So attachment and that kind of sort of love actually is different. So contradiction means what? No contradiction.
So there is no contradiction there.
And then also you see, sometimes you see people get wrong impression, wrong understanding or misunderstanding. Buddha Dharma, you see, they stress the importance of sort of reduced desire. But there, desire is a different kind of desire. Desire something positive, something good. Desire must be there. Actually, the most important part of Buddhist practice is bodhicitta, infinite altruism. There also, desire is very important element. We must cultivate that kind of desire. So negative desire, biased or short-sighted sort of desire, that must sort of reduce. And then even sort of egoistic sort of attitude. Buddhism stress selflessness. But selflessness does not mean, or even it's a selfishness, that does not mean, or say they completely sort of kasoda, disappear, ego feeling. No, ego feeling must be there. In order to develop infinite compassion, infinite sort of altruism, you need self-confidence, tremendous willpower. For that, ego, strong sense of strong self is very necessary. Without that, you can't develop that kind of will. For example, so long space remain, so long sentient beings suffering remain, I will remain in order to serve them. Such sort of limitless willpower need the sound basis, that's strong self. So, and anger, the emotions or mind, something sort of the, I think like a computer, where many elements involved. No? Just one sort of element, you see, cannot function like that. So similarly, anger, out of compassion, out of sense of concern, out of wisdom, sometimes anger also can be very positive anger. So out of ignorance, out of attachment, anger comes, destructive anger, negative. So we need
more details of precision where? Yawachaya.
Distinction.
Distinction. That's important. So we need, not as a religious subject, but something like the knowledge about mind, about emotion. Since last year, I suggested to some sort of concerned people, tomorrow I'm going, there, and I'm going to meet, some scholars who are already working in these things. I suggested, it seems, in Buddha Dharma, there are three categories. One, the reality about matters, external things, and mind or consciousness, as I briefly mentioned before, these as inner science. Science about matters and mind. That we should treat it as a science, not a religious sort of subject. Then concept, like concept of impermanence, is based on the reality. So first, study the reality. Then on that basis, conclusion, some idea. Oh, things are momentarily changing, so impermanence. And things are relative, no absolute, therefore selflessness. You see, these concepts then come. So these two things are universal, nothing to do with religion. Then after that, religion. Now how to train is our mind, and including some sort of rituals or these things, or vows or these things. That's religion, religious side. So obviously, there are three categories: science, concept or philosophy, and religion. Now we are working, these three things separately. Religion for Buddhist, but science, which comes from Buddhist literature and Buddhist philosophy, some, of course, directly related with religion, but some just the universal sort of view. So these should be universal, said as a sort of academic sort of kasoda, academic subject. So usually I introduce the great master of Nalanda, like Nagarjuna, Arya Deva, and Arya Asanga, and these, I introduce. For Buddhist, of course, these are Buddhist master of Nalanda. But in academy level, we can describe these are professors of Nalanda University. Academician. You see, their work, like Nagarjuna's work, always reasoning, not form of prayer. No. Always reasoning. That's why Nalanda tradition, like Dignak, Dharmakirti, and then Shantarakshita, who visited Tibet and passed away in Tibet. He himself, great logician. So then Tibetans themselves also, eventually, develop great logicians among Tibetans. I think very rare among Chinese Buddhists, because no translation of these important Buddhist logic, of a text of Buddhist logic, like Dignak's work, Dharmakirti work, or Shantarakshita's work, like that. So these are simply academic thing. If you use for religion, yes, good. But we can treat them separately as an academic subject, like that. What is the matter? Well, how this explanation come?
Contradiction.
I forget now. Oh, contradiction.
Contradiction. No,
or contradiction. Or, so you see, the, we need study or fuller knowledge about mental system, world of mind. I think very important. Now, as I mentioned earlier, so some scientists now really paying more attention to learn and mapping these different emotions. Next question.
In the path to spiritual awareness, how do we act towards other people around us who are doing harm in the society? Where to find compassion for those who are wicked?
Harmful for the society, somewhere. Harmful for the society, then that is quite serious. So out of genuine sense of sort of compassion, sense of concern of well-being, not only society, but also the perpetrator, survey. Perpetrator. Purely sense of concern of their well-being, in long-term well-being, we need appropriate sort of countermeasure to stop. That is very necessary. So, in the name of sort of altruism, whatever they do, something, even very harmful for the society, just you remain because of the neutral or indifferent, it's wrong. The very, I very clearly mentioned one of Bodhisattva sort of precept. Something going to harm other or going to carry some activities actually long-term harmful, if you have some ability to stop that, if you do not, that's one
fault.
One fault. So once we accept, once we take Bodhisattva vow, the 18 main precept and 46 minor precept. One of the 46 minor precept is if you have the ability to stop wrongdoing. In fact that you didn't, is wrong. You must take appropriate counteraction to stop that. Not out of anger, but out of compassion, out of karuna, like that. Next question.
His Holiness, Your Holiness, is it selfish to remain happy in the times when the whole world is in turmoil and in troubled times? Is it not human to plunge into troubled times and try to set it right?
These days, I am sort of telling audience, last, I think at least 3,000 years, or 3,000 to 4,000 years, people, human being, put our hope on prayer, pray to God, pray to Lord, pray to Buddha. Then last two centuries, around two centuries, technology developed with the help of science. All those wish, several centuries we just put on faith, oh, God will provide these things, but fail. So these things then produce by technology and science. So naturally, we put more, sort of, what's the attention?
Emphasis.
More
emphasis.
Emphasis on technology, science. It really transformed world, in generally speaking. Meantime, I always telling people, the 20th century actually become century of bloodshed. sensual violence. Concept of war, 1,000 years old, even in Buddha's time, war there. But destruction is very limited because of the weapons. The destructiveness is very limited. In last century, including nuclear weapon, with help of technology and science, the destructiveness, power of destruction is much increased. As a result, the 20th century, according to some historian, over 200 million of people killed through violence. So it is in my sort of the meeting with some scientists, scientific meeting, I usually is expressing, it is quite a pity. Science and technology, which was the I think, what say, a human brilliant mind or intelligence, because of the innovated way.
Innovated.
Wonderful. But some of them becoming destructive forces bring more suffering, more fear, more distrust. So it is quite a pity. So now the field of science should pay more attention about moral ethics in order to utilize scientific knowledge for construction, not destruction. So last now, I think later part of 20th century, including among the scientists, and also the ordinary people, and wealthier people, began to feel the limitation of material value. So they turn towards inner values or spirituality. So things are changing. Now, for example, China, people from China, in early period, deliberately destroy religious faith and describe any religion as an opium. And then, now recently, since the opening of economy openness, liberalization in economy field, now the material development values, especially in coastal area, really is transformed greatly. But recently, I noticed one article. You see, they mentioned one university in China surveyed how many Buddhists in China. According to their survey, about 300 million of people now showing, following Buddha Dharma. So these things, clear indication, people now eventually experience limitation of material value. So turn towards spiritual value. So this, I think, the overall sort of picture. And then individually, as I mentioned earlier, the ultimate source of satisfaction or joyfulness or calm is within ourselves. So now some well-reliable scientists also now telling us the inner value is ultimately most important part. So many people, many philosophers, many thinkers feel or realize now under the sort of material, beautiful material development underneath some kind of moral crisis is happening.
So therefore, once we realize the deeper value, that's the only way to turn the world becoming more calm, more compassionate world. So I usually describe the 20th century becomes century of bloodshed, century of violence. Now this century, 21st century, should be century of dialogue. That means problem there, remain there. So long we human being with smart brain, some kind of different opinion, some kind of different interest, always there. So these are the potentially cause of problem. So when we face these things, instead of solving through using force, not that kind of response, but how to solve these differences through dialogue. So we must develop the willpower whenever we face some problem, how to solve this through dialogue. Dialogue means sort of, I think both sides win. As our Tibetan sort of, our effort to solving Tibetan problem, dialogue means, you see, not one side winner, one side loser, not that way, but both sides win. So that's the only way. That's the only practical, realistic method. How can solve problems through force? That's out of date. You see, the concept of war is out of date. I always telling people, now this century should be century of dialogue, century of peaceful, and eventually our whole global level, we should think, we should make effort, you should educate people. Our ultimate aim should be the demilitarized world. That's our should be our long-term aim. So like that. So they're thinking these lines with such sort of vision and make effort on individual level, then family level, then community level, then national level or international level. I think that's the way. Change on this planet. Initiative must come through individual, not from government, not from United Nations. But we individual must start some effort. Firstly, peace, inner peace, develop within ourselves, individual. Then our family, then our community. Once one family, whenever they face some problems, not forcing each other, but dialogue, try to solve through non-violent way. Then 10 families. 100 families, 1,000 families, we can extend like that. So one of my, I think a Mexican friend, one time they told me they are trying to some kind of zone of peace within their own sort of community. Firstly, you see, 10 family, then 100 family, within that sort of area, if some conflict about to come, immediately try to solve through non-violent way. So they call zone of peace, their own sort of limited area. So these are really, I think, the practical sort of contribution to create. Through prayer, peace. Recently I was in Hiroshima. Some Nobel laureates there. And actually, make voice, the free nuclear weapon world, like that. So the last day, we have some sort of more formal or ceremonial way. Many Japanese there, and Nobel laureates, and some different sort of big companies. And the locals, the mayors and these things, these people there. Then the other Nobel laureate also spoke
the action is important, then my turn, I express the world peace, free nuclear world, never materialized through prayer, only through action. So we must work hard. The individual prayer, very useful, but for community, for world, prayer will not bring our goal. And then last year, at Patna, the President Chief Minister, he re-elected the President of the Chief Minister. He invited me to open ceremony, one Bihara in Patna. I went there. Then he, at the function, he mentioned, due to Buddha's blessing, Bihar state rapidly progress. He mentioned that. Then my turn. Of course, I know Chief Minister quite well, so I responded to him. If due to Buddha's blessing, Bihar state, kind of the rapid prosperity, then Bihar state much earlier must progress, must develop, because Buddha's blessing always there. But the reality, Buddha's blessing entirely depend on able chief minister's hand. So that means, you see, prayer, the limitation, just wishful thinking. But act, the India's tradition, law of karma. Karma means action. So everything, you see, due to karma, due to its own causes, conditions. So among the cause, karma, action. So the action is really very, very important. Sometimes we religious people also talk too much, little action. This morning, I visited St. Joseph College. I really praised the Christian brothers and sisters, really made the greatest contribution regarding education on this whole world. Buddhist monk, very little. Recently, the Ramakrishnan mission now really making effort for education. Otherwise, it's very, very few. Only Christian people, Christian brothers and sisters, really made tremendous sort of contribution regarding education and health. So some many years ago, I think in 40 years ago, one time group of sort of the senior monk, Tibetan monk, I suggested, look, Christian brothers and sisters, you see, really dedicated well-being of public, their education, and mainly in the field of education and health. We Buddhist monks, nuns, now must follow our Christian brothers, sisters sort of pattern. 40 years ago, like that. So, the Karshe Gori, the truth.
People who make conflictory.
So it's a change ultimately depend on individual. So should not think when we see full of problems, then you feel some kind of helplessness. Should not think that way. Firstly, you yourself, out of awareness, pay more attention about inner value. Then share with your own family member, your own neighbor, families, like that. I think that's the way. Yes?
Your Holiness, regardless of what religion we belong to, please enlighten us with a method for peace of mind in everyday life.
No.
all major religious tradition, same potential, utilizing different method or different way of approach. For example, concept of creator. From the viewpoint of a non-theistic religion, then that is contradictory philosophy. But people, to some people, the concept of creator, very, very powerful. Look, Mother Teresa and her follower, they really dedicated people. All these strength come from Christian faith. And as I mentioned earlier, I have a lot of sort of Christian friends who really practice very sincerely about love, compassion, out of their tremendous faith to God. And also among the Muslim also. So now, I want to share with you, and many occasions I was telling, the concept of one truth, one religion, and concept of several truths and several religion. These two things apparently contradiction. But you see, in the terms of the society, then concept of one truth, one religion is not relevant. Concept of several truth, several religion is relevant. One individual level, concept of one truth, one religion is very relevant. So for example, I myself, I'm Buddhist. Sometimes I also describe I'm staunch Buddhist. That means I study all these great masters of Nalanda who argue with other sort of philosophical view, including creator, a lot of sort of argument, and put a lot of sort of contradictions. So I study these things. So therefore, I describe myself as a strong Buddhist. But at the same time, I really sort of respect or admire and appreciation of the contribution of these other world major religious traditions. 1,000 years to millions of people, they really brought inner peace, values, moral principle like that. So sufficient reason to respect them. And different contradictory philosophy is necessary for humanity. Now, within the follow of Buddha, because of different mental disposition, Buddha, you see, taught different contradictory philosophy to his follower. Because there is big different mental disposition, So it is necessary, according their mental disposition, you see, Buddha shows different philosophy. So, what we can learn from that, easily, we need different way of approach to millions of human beings and different occasion, I mean different time, different location. We need different way of approach. So these theistic religion, non-theistic religion, and within theistic or non-theistic, again, you see differences there. So these are really necessary. Sometimes, not out of disrespect, but with respect, I usually see telling people, like a supermarket or a good restaurant, variety of food, and more sort of, then benefit more customers. If one, I think, 5-star hotel, just one kind of meal, or breakfast, same, lunch, same, dinner, same, every day, I think customer, then day by day reduce. So similarly, even you see, they compare mind, physical, not much differences. But even then, you see, we need a different variety of dishes. So then mental level, much more sophisticated. So we need variety of different sort of way of approach. And the ultimate message is same, message of love, compassion, forgiveness, these things. So when we, now again, one time in Chile, or Argentina, one meeting with some scientist, some religious leader. So one scientist, one physicist, great physicist, he mentioned, he is physicist. He loves his own sort of field, physics, right? But he should not develop attachment towards his own field. That great sort of teaching. When he mentioned that, and I immediately sort of reflect, oh, I'm Buddhist, but I should not develop attachment towards Buddhism. If I develop attachment, then my attitude biased. Then only Buddhism is good, not other. Because your mind, mental state not biased, so not objective. So that, then all major religious tradition was the same message of love, compassion. Reason different, but main message is same. And with that, tolerance, forgiveness, and self-discipline, and contentment. These things almost exactly same. Of course, there may be different sort of presentation because of different philosophical background. Otherwise, it's the same message, same practice. Like that. So then common practice of love, compassion. On top of that, as I mentioned earlier, in the secular way to promote these things, there I usually use three reasons. One, our common experience. We all come from our mother. We all have the experience, tremendous affection from our mother. So in our blood, the appreciation of affection is there. So till our death, affection, surrounded by affection, you really get inner peace. So firstly, you yourself show other affection. Then others' response also usually is to come that way. If you remain self-centered attitude, extreme self-centered attitude, there are no differences about sort of suffering, about other sort of the problems, and how can you expect some affection from other? First, you must extend your affection to other. Then response from other come. So most, that's our common experience. Then common sense. If you look your neighbor, where more compassionate atmosphere, much happier. The home or family where often is full of jealousy, full of sort of competition within the member of the family, no peace, no harmony, no friendship. That's our common sense. Then latest scientific finding. More compassionate mind, your body much healthier. So recently, some of our meeting with scientists, the slogan, healthy mind, healthy body. So, very helpful, you see, to realize importance of mental health for physical health, like that. So there are variety of method, secular way to promote. Then on theistic religious way, or non-theistic religious way, like that. And then main thing, I think these eventually should include in education curriculum, in education system. Education is universal. So, not touching religion, but secular way, like India's constitution, secular basis. According to the reality of this country, so many religion. If the constitution based on faith, then what faith? There are a lot of complication. So secular. Secular does not mean disrespect of religion, but respect all religions and also respect non-believers. Mr. Advani, of course I know many years. So one occasion, he told me one of the reasons the democratic system success here, this country, is 1,000-year-old India's tradition, among the sort of theoretician, philosopher, different philosophy. So he mentioned one example, the Charvaka tradition. Actually, nihilistic view. No concept of next life, or no concept of religion, no concept of God or these things. Simply just this life. So, in the philosophical field, the major philosophical philosophers criticize, even sometimes condemn that view, Charvaka view, nihilism. But person who hold that view refer rishi. Rishi means sage. So it indicates respect. Person who hold wrong view still respect. So that is the India's tradition. So he mentioned that is the 1,000-year-old tradition. That's why you see the democracy very successful here. He mentioned, I think that's wonderful. So attachment, one's own tradition, our attitude become biased. Remain calm or open. That's very important. Now, next question.
Your Holiness, due to the shortage of time, I think that'll be the last question. So in one of your talks, you said we should be intelligently selfish. Oh? Can you explain this?
Krishna. Ka. Oh. I'm practicing compassion or infinite love, infinite altruism. As soon as I wake up from sort of the sleep, I remember Buddha's teaching, greatness of his teaching, infinite love. And a concept of emptiness. Then whole day, whenever I have some opportunity, even you see when the airport airplane delayed 1 hour, half an hour, some meditation, if there's possibility, just to think. And airplane also, you see the other passenger, walla, talk like that. I always do some meditation. So I practice deliberately as much as I can about altruism. That practice may not bring some benefit to other directly, but immense benefit to myself. So that I call wise selfish. That ordinary people, you see, extreme self-centered, then bully other, cheating other, lying other, hypocritic expression, finally, you lose. So that's foolish, selfish. Clear? And also those, I think, wise sort of businessmen, unless you spend something, you cannot get the more benefit or profit. You must spend more, then you get more profit, right? So like that. So mentally. And again, when 2008 crisis happened, after 10th March, I developed similar sort of anxiety and sense of helplessness, which I experienced 1959, 10th March. But then I visualized, the next few weeks, I visualized those troublemaker imagination. I visualized them, and then the one practice, they take and give. Take means their fear, their anxiety, their anger, their suspicion, take. Take oneself, and then give my sort of love and compassion and forgiveness, give them through imagination. Take and give sort of practice. Of course, it won't help the real problem, but immense help maintain my peace of mind. So like that, these are think about others' well-being. Result, you get maximum benefit. So that's why I often use it telling, why selfish? Everybody, you see, the feeling of I is there. So self-cherishing always there. It is necessary. It is right. But the way to take care of oneself with wisdom. So that's why they use human intelligence maximum way, then you get conviction. That conviction eventually transform our emotion. So like that. And then also you see tremendous faith to God. And whenever you face just some people who usually you get some irritation, then think, image of God, that person, image of God. One time in Jerusalem, our meeting, one Jewish teacher, he told our meeting, one occasion he told in his class, his student, some place is also there, so he told them, when you face some sort of people, like Israeli checkposts or guard, these things, you should remember them, image of God. So after some time, some student then expressed to him, after they learned his sort of advice, they implement that, so that immense benefit. When they passing through checkpost, usually you get some irritation. But think this Israeli soldier as God, the image of God, that immense sort of help to reduce mental irritation. So that also is a tremendous sort of helpful, like that. So whether theist religion or non-theist religion, and then also is sometime ago, I think several years ago, I met Kasa, Father Griffith Kasa. Griffith. Like, looks sadhu. I think you may know. No, okay. So, one time I met, of course I know from India, several times I met. One time in Australia, I met him, and I asked him, why is it Christian, regarding Christianity, why is it you do not accept the next life, rebirth, and previous life? He mentioned the reason, this very life created by God. So that really very, very powerful. This very life created by God directly, that develop
tremendous sort of feeling of intimacy with God. Then description of God is infinite love, compassion. No religion mentioned our God is full of anger. Nobody said that. God always described infinite love. So believe that and oneself created directly by that, so that bring immense sort of faith, so willingness to follow the God's sort of guidance. That is practice of love, compassion. And entire humanity look as a sort of brothers, sisters, same source, created by same God. So if you really take your faith seriously, sincerely, immense sort of powerful, then non-theistic religion, everything due to karma. If you done good, if you do good thing for other, you get benefit. If you do harm other, you get negative consequences. So all these way of approach, very, very powerful, very useful. So according your own mental disposition, to some people, they, because of their way of approach according theistic, if that more effective, then follow that. Then the way of approach, the law of causality more effective, then follow that. Then someone neither because of that interest neither way, then using common sense, common experience, and scientific finding, be more compassionate person. That's the best way to bring inner peace. Through that way, your life becoming more happier life. Okay. Thank you.